part of the Press Play Podcast Network.
Welcome to another Reghi and Roda podcast powered by MGM Northfield Park right here on the Press Play Podcast Network. And as we always do, deservedly so, couldn't start the show without him. Give some love to our fantastic producer, Ty Courts, making sure all of you out there in the podcastosphere get this wherever you listen to your podcasts. And Michael, for football fans in the Buckeye State this weekend as we tape this on a Sunday night, not a good weekend as the Browns fall today in Denver to the Broncos 29-12, and the Buckeyes for the third year in a row defeated by that team up north. Final one, that one a little closer, 30-24, and we're going to break down both of those games here today on the R&R podcast. And we'll start with the Broncos-Browns game today, Michael. And this was a game they never play well in the Mile High City, right? Denver has been on a roll. You're starting a rookie quarterback in Dorian Thompson-Robinson. If we were playing the schedule game, and I think you and I did this last week, we looked at this one and said, well, you know what? If they can go 1-1 in these next two road games, that would be good for the Browns. And we thought this one would probably be the loss. And I think we were dead on that, Michael. But it was frustrating for me as I watched this game with the Stark County Browns backers at Jersey Sports Bar and Grill in Canton that before the game, I heard and read so much about how horrible the run defense was for the Denver Broncos. And yet the running backs only carried the ball 16 times today. And Stefanski threw it 42 times with Dorian Thompson-Robinson and Kid Dynamite PJ Walker. I did not understand that, and I thought that really hurt the Browns' chances today.
I'm 100% with you, my man. And I thought really that this was going to be a day that Stefanski, given because of the difficulty, right, that Denver has had in stopping the run, that Stefanski was going to say to his O-line, all right, fellas, lather up, baby, because this one's going to be with you.
Right.
Okay, this is going to be your time to shine. We're kind of putting, I know none of you carry the football or catch it or throw it, but this is going to be your day because everybody else in the NFL is busting these guys defensively and running the hell out of it against them. So we're going to do the same thing today. No, that didn't happen. Instead, you know, look, and as I said, maybe Dorian Thompson-Robinson's going to have a nice career. Maybe he'll be an NFL backup, Ken. Maybe he'll wind up being a starter somewhere in time. Who knows? But I'll tell you this, the young man isn't ready right now. He's not ready right now to Kenny, you can't, why are you asking him to throw 42 times?
Well, here it was between Walker
and Walker.
Robinson.
So, yeah. But they threw the football 42 times.
Right. Yeah.
No, that's not the way you should go about. You want to shorten the game against Denver.
Yeah.
You want to run the football against them. Don't give Russell Wilson any extra possessions and any opportunities. And Stefanski and the coaches, Ken, did exactly the opposite of that.
Yep.
How do you explain that?
I don't have words to explain. I don't understand it. It's like it's the simplest thing. The KISS theory. Keep it simple, stupid, right? Okay, here's the elephant in the room, their run defense. We should attack that. Instead, let's throw the shit out of the football with a rookie quarterback and a journeyman backup in PJ Walker instead of giving it to Kareem Hunt and Jerome Ford 35 times in this game and take our chances that way. It made no sense to me whatsoever, just like it made no sense to me when they tried that double reverse in the second half. And Pierre Strong, who hadn't played the entire game or carried the ball, excuse me, the entire game, is the guy you're giving the ball to there. And he fumbles it. I mean, that sometimes, you know, we gave Stefanski credit last week, deservedly so, right?
Yes,
well,
right.
This week,
which we always will do.
Take the ball away from him, man.
Oh, yeah. Well, And again, you got, why are you resorting again? Why are you pulling out that gadget, bad high school stuff? And I apologize to all my high school coaching friends and what have you. But why are you resorting to that?
Yeah.
Again, and you said 42 throws today, and 42 throws, and they ran the football, I think it was 24 times.
Yeah, 16 with disparity. The running backs, right?
Without your main guy, of course. But, hey, listen, Jerome Ford has carried the foot, you know, has done a nice job running the football in the absence of Nick Chubb. Done a nice job. I don't think they use Kareem Hunt enough, but maybe there's things going on that Hunt's not showing that he still deserves that main role in a running back room. I don't know, but I still think they got to give him the football more. He's more Kenny. It's now all red zone with him.
Right.
They give him the ball in the red zone.
He's the touchdown.
That having been said, again, that play disparity today. No, man, you can't go 42 throws
right
on the road there with these with Dorian Thompson-Robinson and P.J. Walker, please. No. Bad. Reg, real bad.
Jerome Ford averaged over 7 yards a carry today, too. So, it was baffling to me. Stefanski has one of these games every once in a while, and you just, you shake your head and you go, okay, well, that's Stefanski. He's pulling one out of his old bag of tricks, and none of those tricks worked today. Three turnovers, three fumbles, P.J. Walker, Pierre Strong, and Harrison Bryant on the – and Reg, come on. Harrison Bryant, I mean, as your emergency quarterback sneak guy or what – Give the ball to Kareem Hunt behind Nick Harris as the lead blocker and pick up the damn yard and move the chains and be done. Don't get cute with me and all that crap. I don't need to see that. It's too much, Stefanski. It just is. So
it's twice today. We just mentioned the first one.
Yep.
And that's the second one. I knew you were going to bring it up, so I'd let you do that. Those two decisions, just – abhorrent.
Yep.
It's just absolutely wrong on every level you can possibly attach it to with what you're doing offensively. Just again, it was like a bad high school team that says, we're going to trick everybody. No, you ain't tricking nobody with that kind of, that's like, That's like a touch football play design on a playground somewhere. It irritates me. It really makes me mad. And you know what? Maybe, okay, they don't win that football game today anyway.
Right.
But when you got, when you're adding to the problems your playing personnel are already having with Denver, with that kind of stuff, decisions you make, I can't get behind that, Ken. I cannot get behind that, and I won't get behind that. And as you said, we've given Kevin Stefanski all kinds of credit here on R&R when it's due. But right. You know what? We're also going to say it like we are tonight when he gets zero credit because he was awful today.
Terrible coaching job today. Absolutely terrible coaching job offensively with this football team. Defensively, they weren't horrible, Reg, but they weren't what we have seen through the previous 10 games for the most part, right? They didn't put pressure on Russell Wilson. I think they had maybe one sack, if that, today. One for 9 yards. And that was Jeremiah Owusu-Koramoah, I think, had that sack. That was it.
Yeah.
They gave up 169 yards rushing, 39 carries. How about that? Sean Payton looking at it and say, hey, the weakness of that team, hey, maybe their run defense. So let's give our running backs and quarterbacks 39 opportunities to run it to the tune of 169 yards and two touchdowns on the ground. I think they had one or two touchdowns rushing all season coming into the game. But they looked at the film,
that's right,
and said, this is their weakness. We're going to exploit it. And they did. And their game plan worked. and that's the veteran Sean Payton with his play calling and Russell Wilson not trying to do too much in that offense and starting to understand it a little bit better. And they get the win 29-12 in the Browns defense. You know, kept them in it for a while. It was 14-12 when they went for the two-point conversion to try and tie the game. And then from that point out, they got outscored 15-0, and the Broncos end up getting the win in the Mile High City.
Denver runs it 39 times for a 169. That's 4.3, yep. Okay, on 39 carries. And yeah, I know you, our listeners, all of you know the NFL. Listen, you run it for better than four a carry. That's probably, and at 39 times, you're controlling the football game. You're yep. controlling the way it's played, time of possession, and you're probably going to win. You're probably going to win when you put those kind of numbers. You decide we're running it today. 39 carries for a 169, 4.3 a carry and a couple of touchdowns. That usually spells win. And it did today for Denver. And, you know, we've talked about this too. I don't like being too overly critical, Ken, of the Browns defensively, because as we know, they've been top five, correct? In the NFL this year,
yes.
On the defensive
side, they're
not
7-4 without their defense. They're winning in spite of their offense because of their defense.
You're right. Now, though, they got it taken to them today.
Yep.
So again, you know, we speak the truth. We're not going to sugarcoat it. They got it taken to them today. When you let your opponent run it 39 times for better than 4 yards a carry, and they keep doing it, at what point does it say to you whether you got to stick, get your strong safety up in the box, whether you got to put another linebacker on the field in lieu of a defensive lineman, get your corners up involved in it too?
Yep.
Did none of that today. They just basically said, well, yeah, I guess Denver's running the football. We're just going to deal with this for 60 minutes. And we just gave you the numbers, and that spells loss. So
the
again,
veteran-
Browns defense, you know, has been a shining star yep. most of the time this year. They were not today. And don't let the score and say, well, they only gave up this amount of points. Well, number one, I think you had to know, if you're looking at it realistically, what did you think you were going to go there with these quarterbacks that you're putting out there and put up 35? If you did, I mean, you're sadly mistaken. Disheartening, dispiriting to me.
The veteran
because
quarterback.
The football game to me, again, if you make some better decisions and look at things a little bit more with some foresight about how you're going to get played, Kenny, it was a winnable football game.
Yeah. The veteran quarterback threw it 22 times. The rookie and journeyman threw it 42 times. If anything, you would have thought it was the other way around. Russell Wilson maybe would sling it because he's the veteran. Instead, it works to their advantage for Denver. They run the ball. They win the game. They're 7-4, right?
Yeah.
In second place, tied with the Steelers, who beat the hapless Bengals now today. So 7-4 Pittsburgh, 7-4 Cleveland. Baltimore's playing the Chargers as we tape this. They're either going to be 9-3 or 8-4. So Cleveland's going to be a game and a half out or a half game out, come Monday morning. And
that's right.
So here's the question to you. In Los Angeles against the Rams, they're not coming home, by the way. Cleveland is staying out they're
going to
stay
out
the left
LA.
Coast. They're going to L.A.
Spending the whole week there.
Yep. So who starts at quarterback for the Browns next week against the Rams at 4:25 p.m. on Sunday? Is it P.J. Walker? Is it Dorian Thompson-Robinson? Or the guy that they brought in who will be 39 in January? I wasn't thrilled with this signing, but after what I saw today, is it Joe Flacco that they put behind center to take on the Rams next Sunday?
I'm starting Joe Flacco.
Are you?
As long as he shows me this week that he gets himself knowledgeable. And if he shows me that, well, if I believe that he can facilitate the system
yeah.
and is able to run the system effectively enough, yep, yeah, I'm starting him. I'm starting him. I don't care if he's 39 years old, Kenny. I also know this. Let's go through all the playoff games he's played in. And I'm not saying he's the same guy as he was, well, none of us are.
Right.
But I, real simple, right? What we hear from, whether it's NBA head coach, NFL head coach, baseball manager, I believe he gives us the best chance to win.
Okay.
And I'm going with that right now. And again, I'm not Dorian Thompson Robinson at some point, certainly hope. The kid shows the capability to be a starting quarterback. That's for the Cleveland Browns. Terrific somewhere down the road. Kenny, I don't think they can survive coming down the stretch with him as the QB. What about you?
I'm with you 100%. I'm not a Flacco guy. After watching him,
I know you're not
play. You know, with the Jets, 3-14.
But I meant about I was asking you about DTR.
I'll get to it here in a sec, Reg. 3-14 last 17 starts. Looked like a statue in the game. Last year, even though he rallied them, onside kick rallied the Jets to beat the Browns in Cleveland. Right. I would have gone in a different direction instead of Flacco. Having said that, after what I've seen. P.J. Walker, I cut him as soon as they land in Los Angeles, okay? Let him go on his merry way. Unless Dorian Thompson-Robinson is in concussion protocol, he might not be able to play. So you may be forced to keep P.J. Walker as your backup. I'm with you. As much as I don't like Flacco, why not? Can it be any worse than DTR or P.J. Walker at this point? I don't know if it can. That's the sad part about this. And you've got to give him a couple of starts and see if there's anything there that's better than rolling out a rookie fifth rounder or a journeyman backup. And if you play him and he stinks, then go to the scrap heap one more time. Get Nick Foles. Bring in Colt McCoy. Anybody but these two guys, for me, and I've said this repeatedly, Dorian Thompson-Robinson was a fifth-round pick for a reason. He played 5 years in college for a reason. If you're any good, you come out after your third year and go pro at quarterback. Right, Reg? Or maybe your fourth year, not your after 5 years and you, explored every avenue of eligibility that you have. So there's a reason he was available there. I'm not a believer in him. Nice kid and everything. Threw his first touchdown pass today. Congratulations. Got a win last week. Fabulous. But not the answer, not the future. Same with P.J. Walker. So by default, yes, I'm with you. I guess I start Joe Flacco next week against the Rams in L.A.
Again, the other thing is, Kenny, with it, I just don't think you can afford to sit pat and maybe that let this season just off what you've been given with this, you know, solid start to have you with everybody near, at least with near the Ravens and with the Steelers atop the division. I just don't think you can sit there and potentially let it go, Ken. I really don't. I'm with you. Maybe, and again, it might be that Flacco isn't the guy, but I cannot see, and I would not continue to start the kid.
Okay.
I think if you do, and this thing comes up in a bad way, meaning, you know, are you going to make the playoffs? Okay, but Ken, we've been talking about, make the playoffs. Win a couple of playoff games. At least get to the AFC championship game. Do you see that happening with this kid as a quarterback?
I do not see it happening with any of these quarterbacks. I think the Browns will be lucky to make the playoffs. And if they win one, God bless them. I just don't think with any of these quarterbacks, they stand a chance to go very far, even if they get there. And I think that's going to be a struggle. Now, it's helping that the Bengals are out of the playoff picture. The Bills lost again today, and their schedule is brutal, right?
Yep.
Rams, Jaguars won again today. They're pretty good. Bears stink. Houston's not bad with C.J. Stroud. Jets stink. Cincinnati stinks. So 1, 2, 3. You got three more wins guaranteed. So you're at 10, which, last week.
10-7. You go 3-3, you're 10-7.
Yeah. So
That's, I guess that'll get you in, don't you think?
Well, 11 again, what are you
going to do when you get in? Then what? Who are you going to beat?
Great
Who are
experience.
You going to beat in the AFC when you get in there at 10-7?
Yeah, no, probably nobody. Not without Deshaun Watson at quarterback.
Correct.
And he, you know, and that's the sad
part. And that
part
isn't happening.
All.
Right.
Now, had you kept Jacoby Brissett as a backup or Joshua Dobbs, then okay. We're talking, and I'm not a big Dobbs guy, but he's better than anybody, including Flacco, that you're rolling out there right now. So
I would agree with that. And you decided to got rid of two quarterbacks, two guys this year.
And you had the money to pay Jacoby Brissett as well. You're under the cap this year. You had the money to keep him as the backup, just in case. You elected eight. Don't need to. We'll go with a rookie fifth-round pick as the backup to Deshaun Watson. And it's biting Andrew Bear in the ass right now.
It is.
One of his worst decisions he's made in his time in Cleveland.
And please don't hit us with, are you making it sound like those guys are Patrick No, we're not.
No.
No, we're not saying that at all. But we're discussing what gives you the greater opportunity to continue what has been putting yourself in position to have a good seat and maybe a home game or two.
Right.
I don't think that's happening now.
No.
Kenny, I see 3-3, maybe 2-4 the rest of the way if they stay the way they are. If they stay the way they are and they just decide, that's what I see. And that's going to get them at, what do we say? It's going to get,
Seven. I think
9-8. Good Lord. 9-8. Don't even want to think about that, man.
Well, that's a possibility, depending on how bad the quarterback play is. The defense can only do so much, and we got to wait and see how serious the injury is to Myles Garrett, his left shoulder, and hurt it in the game, left with his arm in a sling after the game today in Denver. All right, that's the Browns take, Reg. I thought I would be feeling better because I thought maybe the Buckeyes would shock the world going into Ann Arbor, and I could wear my new homage shirt that I got in the mail the other day, my OHIO t-shirt, long sleeve. This thing's so soft, so stylish. I got the black with the white lettering across the front and everything. I'm not wearing that sucker because, the Buckeyes for the third year in a row lost to Michigan up there in Ann Arbor. But if you want some sweet gear from Homage, by all means, you can go check it out and make sure you mention Reghi and Roda. The website to go to is Homage. homage.sjv.lo/Reghi and Roda. All right. Make sure you tag it with Reghi and Roda. And you can check out the great gear that they have from the NFL officially licensed stuff, NBA, college, Major League Baseball, WNBA. So I got the OHIO shirt. What shirt did you get, Reg?
Browns.
You got a brown shirt? Okay.
I got a brown shirt, yeah.
You going to wear that one?
Hell yeah, I'm going to wear it.
Yeah. Okay, all right.
I'm very unhappy with what happened today. But, like I just said, to me, you don't want this season, Kenny, to just come undone and unglued now. And don't tag in. Stop. Don't injuries. Everybody's got injuries, man. Everybody has issues with that at points and times throughout the course of a year. So I'm going to root for them and hope that they can find a way. I think it's going to be 3-3. I hope I'm wrong. The final six we're talking about. That's what I'm looking at, 3-3, and that'll put them at, 10-7?
10-7, yeah. So, all right, you wear your Browns Homage shirt.
I'll be wearing my Browns Homage shirt.
I'll wear my OHIO shirt from Homage, hoping that the back door is open again this year for the Buckeyes and that they get help.
You want 2 years in a row for the back door to be open.
Why
not? You got it last year.
I know.
You want it again. Huh?
Why not? Because this is the last year where it's four. So, Reds, next year, they'll be in. Them and Michigan will be the two teams representing the Big Ten next year in it, no matter what. So, this year, let's do this. Let's get a break in. And I'll give you what we got to talk about Michigan. Physicaling Ohio State and winning for the third year in a row. We'll get into the the dream scenario that could lead the Buckeyes into the playoff even after the loss. And we'll wear our homage shirts proudly, you as a Browns backer and me as an Ohio State backer. Right. We'll get into all that when we return to the R&R podcast.
What's up, everyone? I'm Holly Wetzel.
And I'm Tyrus Powell.
And we are your hosts of the Orange is Oranger, a Cleveland Browns podcast on the Press Play Podcast Network. We give you all the dog pound coverage that you'll need to get you through the regular season, hopeful postseason, and I'd say offseason, Tyvus, but is there really ever an offseason for this team?
Thankfully for our podcast, Holly, there really never is when it comes to the Cleveland Browns. Don't miss our breakdown of each week's matchup, game recaps, and any and all news out of Berea to feed your Browns appetite. As we know, Holly, dogs gotta eat.
Yes, they do. So hit that subscribe button and never miss an episode of the Orange is Oranger, Cleveland Browns podcast on the Press Play Podcast Network.
Hey, everybody, it's Sam Amico from Cavs on the Break NBA podcast. Be sure to give us a listen for all your Cleveland Cavaliers recaps, analysis, breakdowns, draft talk, free agency. The list goes on and on. Give us a listen, Cavs on the Break NBA podcast.
Hey, the Roadman, Kenny Roda here for the Reghi and Roda podcast, and Northfield Park is our title sponsor, MGM Northfield Park. Glad to have them back, and Northfield Park is your home for live and simulcast racing. Live racing, how about this? Every Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Saturday, and Sunday. That's 5 days a week. First post is 6 p.m. for that. And how about this? Thursday, November 30th, fans will receive a free $5 match play from 1 p.m. to 2 p.m., and then on Sunday, December 3rd, a handicapping contest beginning at 11 a.m. featuring Aqueduct. The winner will be paid the next day. You got to check that all out. Where? MGM Northfield Park, where it's free admission, free parking every day. And tell them Reghi and Roda sent you.
Looking for new insights on the Cleveland sports scene with a unique side of Cleveland sports history? Then you found the perfect podcast. I'm John Sable.
And I'm Scott Sable, and we're hosts of the Sable Brothers on the Baseline podcast, a podcast about Cleveland sports, but not your typical podcast about the land's sports teams. Join us as we embark on a journey of sharing a unique and historical side of Cleveland sports history with the help of some former Cleveland sports stars and other historical figures.
All right here on the Sable Brothers on the Baseline podcast, part of the Press Play Podcast Network.
And we continue with the R&R podcast here on the Press Play Podcast Network, powered by MGM Northfield Park. And Michael Reghi, third year in a row, hat trick. Third time wasn't the charm for Ryan Day and the Buckeyes. Michigan in Ann Arbor takes down the Buckeyes. Final score on Saturday, Michigan 30, Ohio State 24. And while the score was closer than the last 2 years, Michael, more of the same physicality on display by Michigan over four quarters, and the Buckeyes, while they hung in there for about three with it, could not match that physicality for four quarters, and the mistakes they made enabled Michigan to pull out another big victory, and now they've got a good chance of winning the Big Ten title against Iowa and getting to the playoff, where the Buckeyes need a lot of help.
I'm going to let you handle the bulk of this because you're the Ohio State aficionado. Yep. Here. I will just, for my part of it, say Ryan Day has a Michigan problem. Okay?
Yep.
He's got a Michigan problem. And you Ohio State fans, if you want to, get mad at me, call me names, you go right ahead. But you know what? You're not being realistic. If you don't think you look in the mirror and look at what has happened the last 3 years, Michigan is far more the physically superior team, the far more aggressive team. And listen to me, Kenny, I love Marvin Harrison. I love Travion Henderson. But here's the deal. Ohio State is flash and dash. That's what they are. That's how they put themselves in position and show what we are to win football games. Now, you can say what you want, but Jim Harbaugh and Michigan are exactly the opposite. Our boss still thinks he's played like he was playing for Bo Schembechler back in the 80s. We're going to pound you down and wear you down. We do not think you can stop our run game for 60 minutes. And even if you do, you ain't going to get a whole lot on us defensively with your offense. Isn't that pretty much it?
Bully ball. It's what it is. It's bully ball.
And that's the way Schembechler taught Harbaugh how to play. And that's what Jim Harbaugh – and he did it at Stanford. He did it in the NFL with the San Francisco 49ers. And he's doing the same thing at Michigan. And before you tell me, okay, about, yeah, well, you know, he went 9-10-2 or 9-3. He was playing. He didn't have the roster he needed or wanted. He was playing with that idiot Rich Rodriguez's player, and then to a little lesser extent, not as big of an idiot, but certainly not a great head football coach, Brady Hoke.
Right.
For Harbaugh's first 3 years, he was playing with those guys, players. That's not the players he wanted and how he wants to play. Well, now he's got a roster with his kind of guys. Are they all the five stars, Ken? Like Ohio State goes and gets?
No.
Nope. No, they're not. But again, so the 3 and 4 stars, are they not more physical and more aggressive? And that's how they want to play. And, I mean, if you're looking at the last 3 years and you're being honest, it sure as hell works for them.
Here's the thing. It's torture as a Buckeye fan watching this. I can't imagine, and I hope it doesn't get to that point, I can't imagine what it was like to go through that for 8 years as a Michigan fan, right? Where you had no chance of winning, and I'm feeling that way now with Ohio State right now. And I agree with you, Ryan Day. But hey, say what you want about his record overall, but bottom line is, you're at Ohio State to what? Beat Michigan, win the Big Ten championship, win a national championship.
That's right. Jim Trussell did.
Yeah.
And John Cooper didn't. Trussell did.
Bingo. And that's who Ryan Day is starting to look like,
well,
right?
He's on that path at 1-3.
Yeah. Newt Cooper, as I called him, because he was supposed to be the second
two
coming
of 13
of
games.
Newt Rockne, right? 2-10-1. 2-10-13
games.
Yep. And he had some of the best college football talent in that 13-year span.
Yes,
he
should
have won at least one, maybe two national championships, and he couldn't because he couldn't beat Michigan and he couldn't win in the bowl games, and Ryan Day's doing the same damn thing to this point.
Well, right now, yeah, exactly. I'll tell you the truth. To me, as I'd love to see what you think about this, Ohio State, because of the way they play – and when it's go, they had a better opportunity last year to beat Georgia and win the national championship than they've had in beating Michigan.
Yeah, they matched up better with Georgia, and they should have beat Georgia again.
Way better,
right?
They lost by a point, and
right,
they kick a field goal, they win. But my point in that is, Georgia's won 2 straight national championships, have they not?
Yeah.
So we can all bitch and moan. Oh my! No, they're the best team in college football. They have been for the last 2 years, right?
Yeah.
Ohio State were right there to beat them. Have they been any right there to beat Michigan?
Well,
no.
Here's what I'll say: they had a chance. As poorly as Kyle McCord, and I'm not a Kyle McCord fan. I said, remember, beginning of the year, Buckeyes are going to lose 2, maybe 3 games, because
yes,
I thought they would have
yep.
lost the Notre Dame game or the Wisconsin game on the road and then lose to Michigan. That would be the 2 there, and then maybe in the bowl game when nobody wants to play because they're not in the playoff. Well, they lost their first. If they don't make it into the playoff, Marvin Harrison ain't playing in a meaningless bowl game. JT Tuimoloau probably isn't playing in a meaningless bowl game, and a couple other guys, so they could lose that second game. And with Kyle McCord as the quarterback, here's the thing with Ryan Day, right? Ryan Day passed on J.J. McCarthy, and I'm not a huge McCarthy fan. He is perfect for what Harbaugh wants, right? Make
exactly.
a few plays, manage the game, stay away from mistakes. What cost them last year against TCU? Well, he made mistakes in that game.
He threw 2 pick sixes.
Yeah, exactly. Okay. So if he stays within himself, he's the perfect game manager for the style of play, with Jim Harbaugh. And how about this? The O-line coach acting as the interim head coach, Sherrone Moore, outcoached Ryan Day yesterday, and yeah. McCarthy was 16 of 20 for like a buck 40 or whatever, a touchdown, no interceptions. And he compliments what they try and do. They play team football, right? That's what we're about, defense, and we're about winning the O-line and the D-line.
That's right.
As long as we don't make mistakes, zero turnovers, two for the Buckeyes, then they're going to win those games the way they do. And they prevailed 30-24, although the Buckeyes were right there in Michigan territory with 30 seconds left with a chance to, you know, make a legend out of somebody. And Kyle McCord panicked and threw a ball he shouldn't have thrown.
That's
intercepted.
Right.
Ball game over. Michigan wins again, and the stench, the pain that you smell and feel as a Buckeye fan, nothing you can do about it. You take your medicine. Lost 3 years in a row, and you hope next year that Ryan Day, if he's back, and more than likely he will be back, you hope next year when they play them in Columbus that Ryan Day has figured something out to beat Michigan next year, because if he loses next year, he will not have another chance to beat Michigan, in my opinion. They'll give him one more year with the new athletic director coming in. But if he loses next year, fourth straight time to Michigan, they'll be looking for a new head football coach.
Yeah, more than likely, because, again, as we say, I don't think anybody is going to let the John Cooper escapade happen again. Mm-hmm. Where you keep him for 13 years and he beats Michigan twice. That they're not going to let Ryan Day or anybody else have a chance to do that again. And that's why I said right now, Ryan Day's got a Michigan problem. He beats everybody else. I think he's a damn good football coach, by the way. I really do. But again, we've seen this before with the man, when you get that and everything starts to tighten up, and Kenny, you've kind of just described it. I mean, there was a lot of pressure yesterday on Day, right? Kept his team in the football game. But, Ken, again, here's what I mean, though, about when you're a flash and finesse football team, and that's what I believe the Ohio State Buckeyes are. And they do it well. Yeah, they've played better defensively this year under Jim Knowles. You know, last year, Michigan just rolled them. I put 45 up and ran for close to 300 yards, and don't tell me about two long Donovan Edwards touchdown runs. Well, they count too, okay? You can't take them away like it didn't happen. Fine. Here's the thing, though, again. Yesterday, Kenny, Ohio State threw the out route to Emeka Abuka for a touchdown, right?
Yeah.
Now they're back to within four. They're back to within three at 27-24. There's 8 minutes and 25 seconds left.
Yep.
You know when Ohio State saw the football again?
105.
Yes, sir. Yep. Michigan went on a 7.5-minute drive. Well, how do you do that, Ken? How do you do that if you're not the more physical, the more tough, the more aggressive, the more, saying we're going to take your manhood because we're not going to give you the football back. And McCarthy threw one pass, Kenny.
Yeah.
One in that sequence. They ran 14 plays and took, 7:25 off the clock. To me, again, say what you want. When you say Ohio State's got better talent, more elite, okay, fine. But don't try to tell me who the more physical, tougher football team is.
That's not in question. That, to me, it's not. And Ryan Day can say all he wants about what Granny Holtz had to say
a while
back, Notre Dame and all that, but Michigan's the more physical team. Hey, Cavaliers are the same way, right? Cavaliers play well against finesse teams. But they do not play well against physical teams because why? They're a finesse team. Same
exactly.
with the Buckeyes. I agree with
they
you.
Are.
And so you either have to recruit different players or you have to find a way with your style of play that counters what Michigan does somehow, some way.
Well,
and,
exactly.
They've been unable to do that in the last three. Now, Day won his first game against Michigan. So he's got one win against them, but the last three Okay, it's three in a row. That's a losing streak. And that's what Ryan Day is on against Michigan. So we'll see if he's able to figure this thing out this offseason. Because like I said, Reg, I don't think he has a chance to come back if he loses again next year to Michigan at home.
Well, it's not about him being fired, but I'm going back to last year now. But that was the thing. 2021 in Ann Arbor was a fluke. It was snowing, and, you know, our players had a problem with, and Michigan got the run game, all of that. Well, we're going to take care of that this year. It was worse last year in Columbus.
Right. Now, Reg, we still don't know about the sign-stealing scandal, and I believe there's something to it, or you don't fire two staff members. So this game was a lot closer than the last two. So that can't be ignored. I'm just saying that cannot be ignored.
In your mind, maybe.
In a lot of people's mind.
Did you win the football game? No.
No,
you didn't win the football game.
I'm saying from their perspective, it was closer.
I can know what you're doing if I'm on defense. But if you come out and I'm a linebacker and you bust me and block me on my ass, what does it help that I think I knew what you were running?
Reg, come on. You mean to tell me that's not an unfair advantage if you know exactly what's coming and you did it with going outside the rules that have been set for college football? To me, that's an unfair advantage. Hey, we've said it before. If you ain't cheating, you ain't trying. And everybody tries to steal signs in games. But when you're sending multiple people to games throughout the Big Ten, videotaping something that is illegal to do, within the college rules, then why it if it doesn't provide an advantage if you go out of your way to do that? There had to be some advantage to it. That's all I'm saying.
All right. Well, we'll that's what you think on that. That's fine. That's fine. So,
yeah.
All I know, I'm going to stand with what I said. Ohio State, look, I've said a million times, whether it's been with Rhoda, KNR, I was born in Detroit, Michigan, okay? Yeah. I went to the Michigan football camps from my seventh grade year through 10th grade year as a high school player. Yeah, and that was Bo Schembechler, okay? I respect that, but – Bo Schembechler taught all of us kids that you respect the hell out of Woody Hayes and Ohio State because they're damn good. They're damn good, okay? Have you ever heard me do that crap about that? And again, I get it. These are fans, okay? But Kenny, you've known me a long time. Have you ever heard me say Ohio State blows Ohio State? Ever?
No.
One time?
No.
Because I never have, because that's not the way I feel, because they're a tremendous, damn good football program that has been over the ages. I said right now, today, Ryan Day's got a Michigan problem.
He does, yes.
So we'll see what he does about it.
Yeah. Now, here's the crazy scenario that I mentioned earlier, Rich, right? Ohio State, and this is for the diehard. The one, the glass is half full. They're still drinking the Kool-Aid and everything, right? Here's what has to happen for them to sneak in the back door of the final college football playoff with four teams, right? Michigan needs to blow out Iowa, win the Big Ten championship game, okay? You need Georgia to beat Alabama, so Alabama and Georgia don't go, right? So Georgia's got to win the SEC. Michigan's got to win the Big Ten. And then Washington beats Oregon. Washington's in, right, as the Pac-12 champion.
They have to be.
And then this is where the Buckeyes need a ton of help. They need Oklahoma State to knock off Texas in the Big 12 championship game. And they need Louisville, who couldn't beat Kentucky this past week, to upset Florida State, who's without their starting quarterback. So if you're a Buckeye fan, here's who you're rooting for this weekend. You're rooting for Michigan. You're rooting for Georgia. You're rooting for Washington. You're rooting for Oklahoma State and you're rooting for Louisville. And if all that happens, the Buckeyes are in as the fourth seed in the college football playoff. That's all. Not a lot to go. That's it.
Well, listen, I'm going to tell you again.
By the way, I won't be wagering on that, Reg. I've learned my lesson.
You will not be? Okay.
I'm not putting anybody down on any of that.
Yeah, I got you. I was very, very surprised. Although last year, according to the committee, it only took Southern Cal, USC, to lose.
Right.
They did.
Yep.
And I guess that's the bottom line that got Ohio State in. After getting beat by 3 touchdowns at home.
Right.
And physically, again, drilled by Michigan. So, no, they didn't get as physically drilled by Michigan. But they lost the football game by a touchdown. And so, if you're the committee, I get it. If you're a fan, you want to say, Kenny, I just don't know if they're going to do that twice.
I doubt it too, Reg. But Oklahoma State or Ohio State, if you're picking between those two, I'm just throwing out, Oklahoma State wins the Big 12. You taking them over Ohio State?
Well, Ohio State's a better football team.
Okay. Louisville upsets Florida State. You taking Louisville over Ohio State?
Louisville's had a hell of a year.
Right. Now,
but they're not good at football team. No.
Now, the one team that I could see them taking, even if they lose a second time, could be Oregon with 2 losses. Bo Nix playing very well. If Oregon beats Washington, they could end up taking Oregon and Washington, right?
Just like Ohio State and Michigan got in from the Big Ten last year. They took 2 teams, so it could happen.
Yes.
I think Oregon's better than Washington.
I do, too, after watching Washington yesterday.
They lost the game. Yeah, I know they lost a game. Yeah.
But as of late, Washington's barely won their last 2 games. And, I mean, walk-off field goal this week by 2 points the previous week. And I was sweating out a parlay I had yesterday on that Washington game. But they came through for me made a nice little payout for me on that.
You've been doing well on the parlays. Good for you.
Not too bad. Yeah.
Good for you. Are you winning money? You won money. I mean,
say that. Not a lot, but I'm up. That's a good thing.
If you're up a nickel, you're doing well.
Exactly. So, yeah. Far-fetched scenario for the Buckeyes.
It is, and again, you got to factor in. You can say, well, this shouldn't matter. Again, I'm not being a gay because I have learned it as a little boy. As I said, I have tremendous respect for the Ohio State football program. Always have. I'm just not sure if they'll find a back door for the same program 2 years in a row.
And even if they do, Kyle McCord is not the answer at quarterback, and that's part of the problem for the Buckeyes. 5 touchdowns, 4 interceptions in the 4 big games this year. Barely beat Notre Dame by 0.5 yard. Penn State, Wisconsin, Michigan, 5 touchdowns, 4 interceptions for Kyle McCord in the biggest games of the year this year. And, that's a Ryan Day decision there, right?
You think he'll be the starter next year?
I hope they somebody in the transfer portal that they're – here's the thing, Reg. Do you realize they have not had a rushing touchdown from their starting quarterback since Justin Fields was the quarterback?
That's crazy. That's crazy.
And if I'm any team playing them, I don't have to respect the potential of a run from the quarterback. I don't even have to respect the potential scramble from a quarterback because that's not – what these guys that they have, calling or running the offense do now. So you just respect the run game, whoever the running backs are, and ignore the quarterbacks even considering running the football. And that's where I'll give yesterday Sherrone Moore credit. He brought in his backup quarterback. They had a little package for him, 20-yard pickup.
Yeah.
So that was nice. McCarthy gives you that ability. And I think the Buckeyes need to go back to finding a quarterback that is a dual threat in order for them to stand a better chance of matching up against Michigan where they just can't stack the line of scrimmage and stop the running back at the line. You've got to have that threat of a run from the quarterback, and I think Ryan Day needs to find somebody. I saw Maurice Claret begging Arch Manning to leave Texas to come to Ohio State. Well, they need to do something because I'm not a Kyle McCord guy.
I was going to ask you, too, if you saw that. So evidently you did. Just so you Ohio State fans, and Maurice Claret was pretty damn hard on basically just saying it's not acceptable the way you're playing or absolutely way you're trying to play, because you know you're not going to beat Michigan with this type of your system and style and the way that you that you're going about doing it. Yeah. So you did see that.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So
yeah.
Like I said, Day's going to get another year. And if he doesn't beat him next year, I think then you know the door's open for. I'm not sure if it would be Vrabel from the Titans leaving the NFL and coming, you know, back to Ohio State. If Hartline elevates to that level, I'm not sure you go with an inexperienced, you know, head coach. Does Urban Meyer dip his toe back in the water after being out of coaching in the college game for a number of years? So it's gotten to that point. That Ryan Day, don't sit down on that seat in your office because it's too damn hot. You better be standing the entire offseason because you are on the hot seat. No question about it. And as I sent out one of my tweets, no ifs, ands, or buts. You're right. He's got a problem. It's in his head. It's on the field. It's everywhere. Ryan Day is turning into John Cooper 2.0.
Yeah, well, yeah, when you lose three in a row in the rivalry game, and, you know, we know the passion / hatred that goes along with this. So, it's not the way you want to go about your business and proceed if you are in the head coaching office as the man with that title with the Ohio State Buckeyes, because you're just not going to last long, because they're not going to let a John Cooper winning two times in 13 years happen again. Nope. You'll never, ever get anywhere close to that chance if you repeatedly lose to Michigan.
Yep, that's the bottom line on that. All right, Reg, we'll see how things play out with championship weekend in college football. We'll see if Joe Flacco starts for the Browns on Sunday against the LA Rams. And next time we do this, we'll break that all down on the R&R podcast.
Sounds like a winner, buddy. And I've got, because I know you guys down at with you and JT, I've got Massillon. This coming week in the state championship game against Akron Holman.
Yeah,
I'm looking forward to it. That should be, it's on Spectrum. You know, that's, that'll be on TV. Well, but I'm really looking forward to that because I don't know. I mean, I've been told that, you know, this is the year for the Massillon Tigers.
Two touchdowns, Reg. They win by two touchdowns this year. That's how good I think they are.
All right.
Tim Terrell does a great job at Holman.
Yeah.
And he won't be intimidated. They rallied to beat Avon this past week, 17-14, after being down 14-3. So they got there. We all thought this was going to be the matchup. And Massillon beat Cincy Anderson 55-7. And they have DeJuan Owens, a dual threat quarterback, who is the first quarterback in Massillon history to run for 1,000 and throw for 1,000. He's a transfer from Copley. He's what they had been missing. That's what the Buckeyes kind of need to, I think, get back to that. Their defense is as good as I've seen in years at the high school level, led by Dorian Pringle, although he's had a knee injury. Not sure if he'll play. They're hoping he'll be back for the title game. But wait till you see Big Mike Wright Jr., about 5'10", 285 pounds.
Yep.
They've got another kid, Cody Fair, I think, maybe, if that's the name off the top of my head, going to NC State. They're just good all the way around, and Nate Moore has done a hell of a job this year. He beat St. Ed's for the second year in a row. So if he doesn't beat Holman and win the state title this year, which would be the first one ever in Massillon history in the playoff era, I don't know when they're going to win it. That's how good I think they are. I like them by two touchdowns. I'm going to go 27-13 Massillon over.
I got you down. And you and JT are going to do a lot on your shows this week.
Yep.
With regard to Massillon.
We'll have both coaches, Coach Tyrrell. We'll have Coach Moore hopefully on as well. Then I think we're doing our show live 3 to 7 right up to kickoff from Tom Benson Hall of Fame Stadium.
And then great. So I'll see you guys there
on the radio. Yeah,
I'll see you guys there. That's great. I always look forward to that. And I'm going to be listening to your shows this week. And
I'll send you copies if you want, Reg. I'll email you copies of the interviews with the coaches if you want. I know you'll get to talk.
We'll
to
get them. We don't get them at Seahawks Games 3. We get them on Wednesday.
Okay.
Wednesday morning.
All right. Yeah. So I'll send you we get. That way you can listen and take notes.
That's fantastic.
Because
I know you and JT will be all about it. Yeah, so that's great stuff.
1480 AM. WHBC.com is where you can listen to the Kenny and JT show live Monday through Friday, 3 to 7. And we'll have the state championship game on the radio while Reg does it on TV on Spectrum. All right, Reg, we'll do this again next Sunday and have a lot to talk about, I'm sure,
at
that time.
I look forward to it, buddy. Can't wait. Great job tonight and have a good week. And I will see you this week. So that's always a good thing. I look forward to it.
Yeah. Thanks again to our producer, Ty. Great job as always. We really appreciate how you get this out to everybody on the Press Play Podcast Network.